everyone else had concluded as hopeless because he could not see. So essentially, hopelessness met up with hope on the highway of life. This man had been ostracized by his community, rejected by his peers, alienated from the help that existed in the time that he lived in. He was unable to resolve this crisis in his life because he could not see. Yet in his despair, he encounters the ableness and the accuracy of the ministry of God. Now, when the disciples saw his condition, it triggered questions in their minds. And they asked the master teacher, who sinned that this man was born blind? Was it him or his parents? Because in their minds, somebody had to have sinned in order for this man to be born blind. But how many know that Jesus' answers are better than our questions? That he answered them and said, neither have sinned, but he was born blind that I can show forth the works of the Father that sent me. In other words, it don't matter why he's blind, because he's not going to be like that for very long. So they asked him, who had sinned, him or his parents? But he said that this was for the glory of God to be made manifest in his life. Now, what was particular in this particular exchange is that the man was blind, he wasn't dead. And they were asking questions about his life right in front of his face. They're like, wow, where did this man mess up at? Who messed up, him or his parents, that he was born blind? How many know that the enemy will always let you hear what people have to say about you? You will always hear the he say and the she say, and sometimes people have no compassion on what it is you're going through. But how many know that God is bigger and better than any negative word that could have gone forth in your life? Amen. Praise God. Thank you, ushers, for your kind and friendly service. You may rest off of your feet. Amen. Thank you. But he told me to tell you just a few things in this text, and I'm going to get out of your way. The first thing he told me to tell you in following the anointing and the instructions of God is that he is still God. Somebody say that with me. He's still God. He is still God. It doesn't matter what you're going through, how long you've been going through it, how bad it may seem in your life, he is still God all by himself. So Jesus stands in the face of the darkness of this man's situation and says, I am the light of the world. And as long as I'm in the world, there is light in the world. But we know that Jesus has ascended to the Father, but now we are in the world. So if Jesus lives in us, then the light of the world is still here. Praise God. So God is too perfect to change his mind. He's too flawless to change his character. He's too gracious to change his measure of grace in your life. He's too accurate to change his ability to change everything that goes on in your life. And his authority stretches far and it stretches wide on your behalf. So even in the midst of the darkness of this man's situation, he was still God. Don't you ever think that because things have blacked out in your life that God has lost control of your situation? Don't you ever think that just because things are going down in your life that God has ceased to be God? The same God that you praise in the good times should be the same God you praise in the bad times. God has not let go of the steering wheel in your life. In fact, he's going to use the ugly situation for his glory. You see, God likes to show off. Amen. That when things go wrong in your life, he sometimes allows an audience to be around. Right. You see, somebody's got to see you go down so they can see you come back up again. Amen. Somebody's got to see you mess up so they can see God's glory pick you up. So God is still God even in the midst of everything that we are going through. And if God ever says, I am in your situation, everything under the sound of his voice has to be subject to the I am. I'm reminded when he sent Moses to Pharaoh and he wanted to tell Pharaoh to let my people go. You see, he said, I got to tell him who I am. Well, without limiting myself by our vocabulary, oh God. He said, if I tell him I'm God, Pharaoh's going to say, well, I'm God too, so why should I listen to your God? He said, if I tell him that I'm king, he's going to say, well, I'm king too. Why should I listen to your king? He said, this is what I'm going to do. Just tell him that the I am sent you. You see, when you say I am, everything that comes behind it falls up under the auspices of the I am. So the next time you get in a bad situation, all you really have to do is say, I am more than a conqueror. The next time you have lack, you ought to say, I have all that I need to get by. And when you put the I am in front of your situation, it has to bow down because God is still God. Thank you. So even in the midst of your mess, we've got to understand that God has not changed his mind about blessing you. God has not changed his mind about healing you. God has not changed his mind about fixing that unfixable situation you may find yourself in. A lot of times we say, well, I'm waiting on the Lord. I'm just waiting on the Lord to come in and fix this situation. But if you were to take a closer look, sometimes the Lord is waiting on you. Sometimes the Lord is waiting on you to go ahead and bless him anyhow, oh God. Sometimes the Lord is waiting on you to tell him how good he is anyhow. Anybody ever had an anyhow praise? I wonder am I the only one that has to praise God with a broken heart? Had to praise God with no money in the bank? I wonder am I the only one that has to praise God on credit? Praise God in advance. Tell God you're still a provider, even if I don't see the provision. Have you ever had to tell God he's still a healer when the lump was still there? Sometimes we say we're waiting on God, but God is waiting on us to bless the Lord at all times. And let his praise continually be in my mouth. Somebody say, he's still God. He's still God. So my next point he told me to tell you is time to change up. Time to change up. You've been doing the same thing. You can expect to receive the same. Okay. And sometimes you got to change up what you're doing and how you're doing it in order to receive something different. So after he finished telling this man he was the light of the world, he did something unorthodox. In the midst of this profound, precise, exegetical sermon he was preaching to his disciples and to the man, he did something a little crazy. So bear with me, just close your eyes real quick. Everyone, close your eyes, close your eyes, close your eyes, close your eyes. This is what the blind man heard from Jesus, the master teacher. This is what the disciples, you can open your eyes, this is what the disciples saw from the master teacher. He was just finished telling them, I'm the light of the world, and if I'm in the world, there's light in the world, and all of a sudden he spat on the ground. Now for those of you that had your eyes closed, I'm sure that sounded nasty. That didn't sound like ministry. That didn't sound like something good was about to come on the other side of that. But he did this because the disciples were used to one set way of him healing. Oh God. They were used to him laying hands and watching the man recover. They were used to him sending his word, and his word was healing everything that went on. But he said, I got to change up this time. I got to switch up this time because they've become too used to my glory. And I need to see if they can follow instructions when the instructions don't make any sense to them. Oh God. So he changed up in just about the most unorthodox way he could think of, and he spat on the ground and began to play in the spittle that was on the ground. And I'm sure his disciples were left scratching their head like, I think the master has finally lost it. All this healing and all this teaching all this running around, he's finally lost his mind. I'm sure the blind man said, well, this must not really be Jesus, because the Jesus I know, if I just got close enough to him, he could heal me just by being in his presence. So everybody around the master was being tested in their faith because he did something different. I wonder if we switched up how we had church. I wonder if we had a Sunday without the announcements. I wonder if we had the preaching first. I wonder if we just had an altar call. I wonder if we shut the door, met in the parking lot, and walked out in the highways and the byways and said, this Sunday, we're going to witness out to. I wonder if we switched up, how many people would know or think that God was still in it? How many know that the church has become too regimented? The church is too strict. The church is too front line, and that people don't think they can get a healing in church anymore. People don't think that God still supplies and delivers because we have boxed God in to a certain way and a certain thing that he has to do. Well, how many know God can shut down a service? God can come up in here. Nothing will happen except for the glory of God. You see, sometimes we become too strict and too tight. When you were in the world, you had another name. I'm going to try not to call names today. But you danced all night long in the club. You didn't even wait for the last call for alcohol. You were the wild one. You always spoke what was on your mind. But now you done got saved. You done got sanctified. You done got cleansed and filled, and you a docile Christian. You won't open your mouth to tell God thank you. But when the oldies came on in the club, oh, that's my jam. And you partied all night long, but now you're in church. You won't even lift up one hand to God. You won't even tell God thank you. God did a radical thing in your life, and now you sit down on his glory like he ain't done nothing for you. In the world, you went hard for the enemy. You went to the club Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. And then if they had one on Sunday, you probably would have went. But now we get into the most radical move ever to exist. I mean, it was a radical move for Jesus to come and die on an old rugged cross. It was a radical move for him to be resurrected on the third day with all power in his hands. It was a radical move for him to pick you up out of the trash can of your sin and turn you around and save your soul and let everybody that saw how you were see how you are now. That was a radical move of God. And if we serve a radical God, he deserves a radical praise.
Aren't you tired of the enemy? It seems like you take one step, he steps two
children spill over into whatever you have going on. You have to follow his instructions. No matter what it seems like, no matter if it makes no sense to you or anybody else, there is anointing in his instructions. This shows vividly in how we deal with our children. My third point is it's time to set the captives free. We always say, ain't nothing new under the sun. But you did, what you're doing now, we did back then. But let me update the files on that particular saying just for a moment. What our children and youth are going through now, at age 12, some of us didn't see until age 20. We tell our children, I done been there, ain't done that. Ain't nothing you doing that. I told my children that too until they started telling me some of the stuff they were going through. Praise God. And we tell them, ain't nothing new under the sun. But some of the things they're dealing with now, we have no point of reference for because we didn't see them until we were almost adults. Praise God. I got to go back to this. That sounds terrible. But some of the things we're dealing with now, they're dealing with now, we have no point of reference for. And that there is a demonic move going on in this generation now. All we had to worry about in the 60s, 70s, and the early 80s was playing old school music. And if I had time, I would bust a bubble on that too. But I don't really have time to express what's really on my heart with that. And that there was not really a message being planted in the music until the early 80s when after the baby boom was up to Generation X. Now we see that there is a movement inside of the music and a movement inside of the culture. And it's a supernatural movement that the artists that are rapping and are singing, they're not just rapping about love and drugs. They're rapping about demonic influence. They're rapping about being overtaken by an occult. They're rapping about selling their soul to the devil. And our children are buying the CDs and buying the clothes and buying the magazines, and they are ascribing to an antichrist system. And Jay-Z just dropped the album quoting scripture, 444. There is biblical reference because he calls himself Jehovah God. The man is older than I am, and he's still making music because it's not about rap. He's got a message to give to our babies. And now they're going through what we have no point of reference for. My kids come home talking to me about two boys holding hands in the middle school. They come home talking about drugs in the bathrooms. Little girls going in the bathroom coming out differently than when they went in, and a little boy telling them that wasn't really sex. See how quiet it just got? Because we have no point of reference for what they're really going through. And then as soon as they tell us a little bit of what's on their mind, we lose our mind because we don't want to believe my little girl like boys, or my little boy is trying to join a gang, or and we don't want to believe our children can be in this amount of warfare. And a lot of it happens in the twinkling of an eye. Before you know it, she's a baby mama. You didn't even know she was having sex. Before you know it, he's coming home bow-eyed, bloodshot red. Because we let life go by, and as long as they got MTV or BET or the Xbox or the PlayStation, then they're going to be all right. I don't really got to raise them. I just got to talk to them every now and then. But if you don't talk to them, Brother Jay-Z and Sister Beyonce going to holler at them. If you don't talk to them, Rihanna and Katy Perry going to have a little talk with them. If you don't talk to them, the hip-hop community are going to shape, form, and fashion what it's like to be a man and a woman. In the hip-hop community, you're not a man until you've gone to jail one time. I don't know about you, but I don't think it's a badge of honor to get a bullet in my chest. I ain't got but one life to live, and that one might be. Here I tell the babies, the girls, use what you got to get what you want. And then they're really tricky in that they'll get on an award show. I'd like to thank my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for this talent and anointing to sing songs that kill a million children. They're attracted to the supernatural nature of the culture. Not understanding, just like church have a preacher and a praise team or a choir, the culture has a preacher and a praise team and a choir. It's called R&B. They'll sing serenading songs, and then they'll get a rapper to come up and do two verses, which would be the text they take in the service. The offering you give is the $10.99 for the CD or the $10.99 for the download to fund the Antichrist agenda. Because the enemy has a church. And now we find our children can't feel the presence of God in this church because they've become a part of the other church. But see, think about being a member in that church. You don't have to come down and say, I want to join this church. All you really have to do is ascribe to what they're singing and what they're saying and get it in your heart. Once you get it in your heart, it's hard to get anything else out of your mouth, because out of the abundance of the heart will the mouth. So it's time for the church to change up. We got to stop coming here in our own stuff and not looking for the glory of God to fall so the captives can be set free. And we've got to embrace the call of the church, which is my fourth point. I'm almost there. We've got to embrace the call of the church. You see, the church has a yoke-breaking anointing in it. The church has the answer to every ill in this world. The church has the answer to the problems that our children and our society is faced with. The problem is that I don't know that we understand the call of the church. The call of the church is to minister to those that have no respect for authority. The call of the church is to help those who are angry and don't really realize why they are angry. The call of the church is to teach them that reject morals and values and have no visions and dreams, and to pull them into a place where they know they can do better because God has done better. The call of the church is to track down those that have no goals and bring them and show them how it is to be a man or a woman. The call of the church is to teach our children how to write resumes. The call of the church is to teach our young ladies it's not about how much you show, it's about how much you know. The call of the church is to tell our young men it is intelligent to speak with complete sentences. It's the call of the church to embrace the outcast and bring them into the fold. It is the call of the church to minister to those who are confused about their sexuality without judging them for loving who they love. It's the call of the church to take all that are drug abusers and alcoholics and say, I used to be there, but look at what the Lord has done. I won't judge you where you are, but I'll minister to you. The same God that saved me and the same God that can save you. Is to talk to them thugs, talk to them mean mugs, tell them put down the gun, pick up a Bible, when you look back over your own shoulder and you made that mistake and that mistake and that mistake, then you look over, I can't look over that shoulder no more. You look over this shoulder and you see that mistake and that mistake. So the call of the church is to reconnect our elders with our babies. The call of the church is to let this generation know they're not Generation X, they're Generation Next. That the same God of our fathers is the same God of our children. So the call of this church is to let them know that once God saves you, once God put his hands on you, you can expect some warfare. But the first time you mess up, don't think that the devil took your salvation. The first time you mess up, don't think that he took something from you that he doesn't even own. That the call of the church is to let them know it's going to show up after a while. My last point, it's going to show up. So he made the salve, the spittle of clay, put it on the blind man's eyes. Now, young people, you got to be prepared for this moment. Older people, you got to be prepared for this moment. He received the ministry of Jesus. He got a touch by Jesus, but he still couldn't see. Jesus made the spittle, put it on his eyes, touched the man, but the man still couldn't see physically. So I submit to you today that that initial touch changed him spiritually. Oh my God. That first touch, see, Jesus wasn't really concerned with the man's physical eyes. The physicality of his blindness was second to the degradation in his soul. Jesus wanted to fix what was on the inside, and then he would be able to follow the instructions and get his healing on the outside. But son, you got to make sure the inside is fixed first before you come running to the master saying, fix what's on the outside. You see, we come running, Lord, fix this, this, and that. When the Lord is saying, if you just give your life to me, I'll fix all of that and then son. So, he touched the man, anointed his eyes, but he still couldn't see. Because he's changed from the inside out. And Jesus knew, if I can fix what's on the inside, and he will follow the instructions to get healed on the outside. So he told the man, go wash in the pool of Siloam. And I'm sure the man was sitting there scratching his head again. I can't believe all the hype about this Jesus. This man's come, spat on the ground, put mud in my eyes, and told me to go somewhere I can't even see. God will anoint you so that you could be able to follow his instructions. You got to learn how to be anointed and still wait. Just because you're anointed doesn't mean you need to jump up and grab a microphone. Just because you're anointed doesn't mean that God has done everything he's doing. Sometimes you got to be like David and wait on the Lord for your ministry. Sometimes you got to wait on the Lord for some of those things to fall off of you. You see, God don't just take everything off of everybody all at once. Sometimes it's a process for some of the things to come off. But don't think he didn't touch you because everything hadn't fallen off of you just yet. So he told the man to go. And the anointing was in the instructions that he gave to the man. He went to the pool of Siloam, which is by interpretation sent. And the man did what seemingly had nothing to do with his dilemma. But because he followed the instructions of God, because he did what seemingly made no sense, but he believed and had faith enough to know that I heard the word, now I've got to go and do the works that the word has inspired. And because he followed the instructions, still blind, mind you, he's blind with something else over his eyes. Oh no. Seemingly coming to Jesus made it worse. But it's going to show up after a while. As I hasten to a close, whatever it is you're going through, whatever it is, whatever dilemma, whatever situation, whatever problem you're faced with, know this, God is still God. Know this, God is still in control. Know this, God has not been caught by surprise. Know this, it's going to show up after a while. If your grandmama prayed for you, if your mama prayed for you, if they pronounced a word of faith over your life, it's going to show up after a while. You may not see it right now. You may not feel it right now. But it's going to show up after a while. He got you to this place so that you could follow his instructions, and on your way to doing what God told you to do, you're going to find your blessing is in the walk. Your blessing is in doing what God said. The anointing, my brothers and sisters, is in the instructions. Stand to your feet, I'm done.